Hello and welcome to the Black Dog Podcast, episode 7, 007.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Cue the Shawns.
Shitting on a dock of a bay.
Watching my tide roll away. Somebody get me a fucking hose pipe. Anyway, hello everybody. Welcome to Black Dog episode 7. We are once again home to Captain Cockup of the technical variety. So if this sounds different or it's a little bit weird, you know, just bear with us because shit, I don't know what's happened. I think we just pressed too many buttons and we've angered the internet gods. So, yeah, that's fun. So, anyway, yes, this week we are going to say hello to everyone, see how their week's been, see how, you know, everything's going on. We're going to have an interesting bit of feedback. And then we will move on to this week's movie, which is Elton's Choice, which is the cheerful, cheerful tale of a cheerful chappie from Leeds who might be a bit of a nutter.
Shut up, you cunt!
Shut up! Shut up, you cunt! Anyway, this is really going to impress everyone who's coming in from listening to Commode and Mayo's podcast, and we got a shout-out on. This is going to work well.
Did we?
Yes, we did.
We got a shout-out on... Christ.
Yeah. So, yeah, but that more about that in...
I'm speechless.
Yeah, we got a shout-out.
I don't know what to say. Honestly, I'm speechless. I haven't got a word in my mouth that I can actually bring out to express how I feel about this moment at all. Yeah. Listen to me, I'm dumbstruck.
You're dumbstruck. There you go. Right, mm-hmm. There you go. So, so on the off chance that anyone's turned up from that, that we got some kind of splashback from that moment of us getting a shout-out on Twitter... And then getting a shout out read out on that podcast. Hello, everybody, and hope you enjoyed your taster episode and hope you stay for more than the 15 seconds you probably left.
It's not always like this.
Oh, it's always like this.
No, it's not.
It is always like this. Anyway, we've done all this and we haven't even said hello. So, hello. My name's Lee.
I'm Darren.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Elton.
And, yeah, like I say, we're going to be doing Bronson this week. This will be our review. It's Elton's Choice, and it was available on Amazon Prime, I believe.
Yeah.
But first, before we get to that, let's see how everyone's week's been. And, yes, I think we're all bloody hell, I'm hitting the mic stand. See, proper professional work here. So, we'll start with Elton. How's your week been, sir, out in the field?
You had to start with me, didn't you?
Yes.
I have nothing to report.
Yay!
I'm worried about treading on stuff that me and Jim were talking in the green room about it being quite warm. But I won't do that.
Is that it?
If we come down to this, are we just discussing the weather now?
That's what I'm worried about, yeah.
That's what we're trying to avoid.
Holy shit.
At the moment, I have an Amazon tab open on my computer. I'm looking at contact cleaners. That's about it.
Oh, that's funny, because I've got a Pornhub tab open on my own. I'm looking at a video of a cleaner. Oh, yes. There we go.
Less said about that, the better, I guess.
Moving on swiftly.
Yeah, see, you don't get this sort of feedback on the BBC. You don't get this kind of conversation.
Yep.
Anyway, okay, well, so it's a little bit warm is your entire takeaway for this week.
It has been a very dry, barren week.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. Well, in which case, moving on to Jim. How are you, sir?
treading lightly here, I'll just say I'm hot.
That's it. It's a bit warm, isn't it?
It is a bit warm. No, I've been fairly busy. End of the month is a busy time, and I don't know. It's just been a bit same old, really. I managed to get a little bit of time and sat out in our garden, which we extensively have been redoing.
Mm-hmm.
Got some new rather swanky garden torches with like flickering solar powered flickering flame effects, and they're nice. Pretty good.
Nice.
And got some fresh herbs now all sprouting and growing. So I did a roast chicken today with some fresh rosemary and thyme picked from the garden, and that was bloody lovely.
Oh, very nice.
That's what it's all about. So I've been fairly busy with moments of chilling.
Nice. Cool. Okie dokie. There you go. This is all feeling very laid back. Very good. Very nice. Mm. Probably a counter.
I have my feet on the table.
You have your feet on the table.
Yeah.
I'm
relaxed.
I'm kicking back with a drink as well. It's quite nice. Right. Okay.
I've got
then.
My clothes on the table. They're not on me. Oh no.
And moving swiftly over, Darren. No. Anyway, go on in, mate. How is your week?
Pretty much like the rest of the guys, except you know, me and my ongoing mission to try and play every single Xbox game that's ever been created. This week, I finished that shark game, by the way.
Oh, Maneater.
Maneater, yeah, the Hall & Oates inspired shark game. Mm-hmm. I finished that this week, and I've got to say I had some great fun playing that. It's a real short game, but yeah, I've got some satisfaction. You might want to wait until it, if you're thinking of playing it, just wait till it comes down to about a tenner.
Yeah.
And then get it. Yeah. I mean, it is good, but it wasn't worth the money I paid for it.
And how much did you pay for it, just out of interest?
I think it's a brand new one, so it's about 30 quid.
Oh, right, okay.
But, yeah, lots of doing it. And I've got to say, the shark, when you actually evolve it to its top level, you become like the apex mega shark in the water. I mean, you're taking out things like bloody blue whales and stuff like this in the water. And it's just great, you know. These things are like 20 levels above you, but if you can get a handle on the combat,
yeah,
they're not a problem.
Okay.
Really not a problem. And you can evolve the shark in different ways. Like you can make it, give it, a bioelectric body so that every time it bites into something, it shocks them. And then slowly, if you keep attacking it, you just knock the bastard thing out. So
right.
It sort of like sits there and you just go in, you're like, yep, fuck it, lunch. I'm in.
Nice.
You know? And it's especially fun as well when you, if you've been going around doing some of the missions where you have to eat a certain amount of humans, hunters turn up to try and take you out. And if you get your threat level up to so high, then like one of the boss of that level of hunter comes in, and if you take them out, then you normally get some kind of evolution to your shark. Like you get a bioelectric head or a bone tail or something like this. Like normal sharks do.
Yeah. You know,
but they play around with this. They've got, barrels of mutagen in the water. So this explains why you just fucking grow to this enormous size.
Barrels
I'm not joking,
of
you're
mutagen.
Bigger than some of the boats. Yeah, barrels of mutagen.
Right.
Or they're like cases. You break into them and all this green stuff comes out of it. And it pushes you with that just a little bit further on in your evolution.
Oh, is that how you level up?
Yeah, it's kind of like that. And I got to the top level. I got top everything. And, you then go back to the places where you had a lot of trouble before. Like, you know, level 8 alligators are a fucking happy meal when you get to that level. It's like...
Right.
Because normally if you kill something that's like a higher level than you, you see chunks of it floating in the water and you can keep going back and eating those and pushing up your like the minerals and that you collect to add this stuff to your body. But when you're higher than them, they just go down in sort of like a couple of bites and that's it. There's nothing left. They're just like a red smear in the water, you know?
Are dolphins little bastards as well?
No, there's no dolphins in this. There are plenty of things like seals that you can eat, and you can hear them squealing as you're biting into them. That's always fun. Yeah. And you hear the crunchy sound as you're biting through a turtle as well, which is, you know, that's always good, I suppose.
It's the Jallo version of Finding Nemo, is it?
It is, yes. Yeah. It's like Finding Nemo 2, this time it's personal, you know?
Nice.
Yeah, but wait till it comes down to about a tenner. cop hold of it. I think you'll have a bit of a laugh of it.
Cool.
So
okay.
There's that. And one other game. I started playing Far Cry 5.
Oh, yeah.
This week, because they had a special deal getting Far Cry 5 and Far Cry 6, which are actually linked, because they take place in the same area. Far Cry 6 being called Far Cry New Dawn, which is set after a nuclear apocalypse.
Right.
So so it's kind of like Fallout, but with a sense of humour.
Oh, right.
But yeah, 5, you play this, was it rookie policeman who goes in with like the sort of like the state marshal to try and take down this cult that's taken over the area. They like everybody was laughing at them. Nobody took any notice of them, and all of a sudden they bought up literally all the farms in the area. They've taken over power stations and stuff like that. And I've got to say, the opening sequence of this game is actually quite tense, especially when the female officer gets grabbed by the cult, if you pardon the expression, and taken away. I know it sounds so wrong, but it's like, what else are you supposed to say? So yeah, she gets taken off, and you do see her come. You see her on the TV a little bit later on, because they've taken over the TV station as well, and they're kind of parading her around as like a hostage. So, yeah, there's lots of fun to be had there, especially if you get DLC for Far Cry 5, which is like, the DLC is, there's one that's based in Vietnam, there's another one that's the standard zombie shooter as well, but there's also another one where you're a space cadet on Mars, and what you do is you get those weapons in Far Cry 5, so you've got this laser pistol that you can have in it as well, that just evaporates, it just destroys everything. It's like having a nuclear explosion. It's like having, you know, the gun from the Men in Black, the noisy cricket.
Yeah.
It's that.
Oh,
it
right.
It's basically that. And I didn't realise how powerful it was. So, you know, remember, folks, when testing new weapons that you've never actually seen or used before, don't fire them on the ground right in front of you. Okay? Because that's all kinds of wrong, you know. But, yeah, there you go. So far, so good.
Nice. Cool. Okay, so that's your week. Basically just trying to do every single Xbox game before you go to the next generation.
Yeah, I mean, I've been playing them so much that my Xbox... I've done so many of the Xbox... You know, you get the points that build up so you can claim them back and buy something. I managed to get a fiver out of Xbox Live, so I went and bought sort of like another game with that.
a penny a game.
Yeah, it's something like this. Or, you know, you do so many things a day, you like fucking well click on these links that you've got and they give you like 5 points.
Right.
Or you do something in a game, like you get an achievement and you get points added to your score. So these slowly build up until you get like, you know, the microwave.
Nice.
Or the fridge. You know, so nice. Yeah,
okay,
I'm looking forward to the George Foreman grill at some point, but you know, then that's in the future at some point.
Cool Okay. Right, well, my week, this is my second day on furlough. I'm officially on furlough now. So I am now officially furloughed. I am just doing no work whatsoever for work. However, what I am doing is work for the house, so to speak. And
DIY, Lee.
Yeah.
Or should I say DI, but why?
Yeah. Well, actually, the line was drawn. Carol drew the line when our cold tap in the main off the mains, the cold tap basically seized up, and it got to the point where basically, rather than risk the entire house basically being flooded and doing a recreation of Titanic, she just said, "Fuck it, get a plumber in and get a tap replaced.
Get a man in, get a bloke.
Get a man in and get which I think is eminently sensible, but you know, I have to say that part of my masculinity, my toxic masculinity was obviously hurt, that I wasn't, you know.
I don't think she wants I don't think she wants another sort of like, you know, one of those fucking, you know, Alexa coming out of a cold tap, you know. So yeah, maybe that was very wise to get someone in.
Well, I think so, but you know, so she's done that. So we got a new tap, and that's all cool. Two guys come in, sorted the whole thing out. Guess how much to replace a tap and buy a, that's including buying the new tap.
Was there a washer involved?
Did they
supply the washer, or did you supply the washer? Because this could tilt. This could seriously affect the price.
They have to go away and buy the washer separately? They'd normally have some, so you have to go and borrow one from his brother.
Right.
We haven't got that kind of washer. We've got to go. We can come back in 3 weeks when we've ordered it from the other side of the planet.
Mm. Yeah, well, go on in. So coming in, here we go. Go on. I'll give you a shiny kudos point if you can work out how much it costs to have two guys come in, take my old tap off, put a new tap on, fix a tap to the sink, test it, and walk away in what was amounting to about half an hour's worth of work. So, Jim, how much you reckon?
£300.
Okay, Darren.
I say, for some reason, I'm getting a message from the void, and it said £270.
All right. Okay, Elton.
Well, I'm going to sound like a plumber, so. Ooh. I reckon £70 for the tap.
Right.
And. £70 to put that fucker on.
Well, I'll give you, you know what? Elton wins because it was £70 for the tap and it was £100 to put it on. So £170 all in.
Yeah, you got closest.
Yeah, so you got in there, mate. Well done. Well done.
Oh, well, I was £100 out. Oh, yeah, man. I'm obviously a bit deaf listening to the spirits.
Well, maybe the spirits have put in two taps.
Maybe. Maybe. Oh, yeah. No. They're telling me, oh, yeah, that is two taps.
Yeah, two taps.
Oh, thanks a bunch, man.
Cheers. Yeah, see? So
I couldn't see it was a mixer tap. That's what his problem was.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so that was that. And then, how can I put it? Then what else has happened this week? Oh, I watched a film. I watched a film that might be worth discussing if at some point if you guys manage to get to see this, because it's not without its flaws, and it's as cheap as chips, but it came out on Amazon this week. And I have to say, after a bit of a rocky start, I was quite impressed with it, which was called A Vast of Night. Has anyone heard of this?
I heard vaguely about it.
Okay. Basically, it's set in a small town in New Mexico in the 1950s. And what it starts off with is an absolute cacophony of about 15 minutes of someone wandering through a basketball game, and he's talking and he's gabbling and people are gabbling at him. And I tell you what, at that point, I almost gave up on the film straight away. And then I went on Reddit and everyone was saying the same thing. This opening is one of these really confusing kind of slice of life things where things are coming at you from every direction. You don't know what's relevant and what's not. But once the thing settles down, it turns out that the main character is a radio DJ, local radio DJ, who wants to get out of town. He wants to become someone, you know, go exploring, go do stuff. And he's kind of slightly sweet on this lady who runs the telephone exchange across town. And she's trying to learn how to do tape recordings and all this kind of thing. And what starts to happen is on the radio, they start getting a weird signal. And she, or the telephone operator, starts to hear weird noises on the telephone exchange. And then strange things start to happen with phone calls. So people will phone up and say, there's something in the sky, there's something, and that sort of thing. And lots of heavy laden atmosphere and lots of quiet moments and some really audacious filming. I can only say that. There's one shot which actually has the lady at the exchange realize that she's got to speak to the guy in the radio station, and she literally runs across town, and the camera for 4.5 minutes, and you think, how the hell did they do this? The camera literally, with an unbroken shot, it's clearly been digitally doctored, but there's an unbroken shot, the camera just takes off with her, then goes around the corner, goes over a fence, goes through a house, goes over another fence, goes through this garden, goes through another bit, and it literally cuts right across town to this guy in a single continuous unbroken take. And you just think, bloody hell, how did they do that? Anyway, the whole thing is really, really heavily laden with atmosphere. There's lots of people talking to you know, speakers, essentially, talking to the people on the radio, and there's one guy who comes up and he just monologues a story about thing that made this sound when he was in the army, and then they go and meet another lady who's got this other problem which is related to the sound, which is with her son, but something weird was going on with her son, and the whole atmosphere really builds up and builds up and builds up to this nice creepy sort of Twilight Zone-esque kind of 1950s fire in the sky Project Blue Book kind of thing going on. And it isn't perfect. The ending kind of decides that it's going to spaff its wad and throw effects, which it clearly can't afford at the screen. But the overall of the film, you come away going, wow, that's actually, for a really tiny budget film, and you can tell it's tiny budget just simply by the way that the whole thing's set up. You know, you've got a DJ on a microphone talking to people, talking to him over a phone. You know, there's no, you know, total amount of actors, 6. You know, it's that sort of thing. But the actual atmosphere of it and the vibe of it and what it's trying to do, I was really impressed with it by the end. But like I say, that first 15 minutes just... You've got to really knuckle down, either put the subtitles on or just accept that none of it really matters. All it's doing is establishing the scene. Because you just, like I say, Carol watched it and she just was like, that's it, I'm out. If the rest of the film is going to be like this, I'm off. And I was like, I'm going to give it another few minutes. And luckily, by that point, it kind of started to calm down. But God, dear. But it's called Vast of Night. And it's on Amazon Prime. And I think for a 90-minute film, for the most part, minus a couple of one or two missteps, I think it's really worth his time.
Ooh, intriguing.
Mm. Mm. Yeah.
And write that down so I won't forget, being a super-hearted moron. I'm thumbing through Amazon going, what the hell am I going to watch?
Yeah. And also, a rather interesting little nod is things like the radio station is called WOTW. Just so little things like that as well, but nice. No, the atmosphere is really good. It evokes 1950s really well as well. So it's got a kind of, it feels a bit like sort of almost like if almost like American Graffiti, isn't it, in some ways as well.
Oh, cool.
So it's really quite nice. It's a nice film. I liked it. I just wish they'd been a bit clearer with the opening, because, like I say, I can see a lot of people getting put off with that. But there you go. Anyway, if you do watch it, guys, if you do watch it, and I really hope you do, I'd really like to have a little chat about it, because there's a lot of it I really enjoyed, and I was just like, oh, I want to talk to someone about it, but I can't.
Well, is it your turn to choose the film this week?
No, it's Jim's turn.
Ah, right. So okay.
Jimothy. But anyway, so apart from that, what else? Oh, last thing, and it is a video game thing. I got Jedi Fallen Order.
Okay.
I have finally returned to the Star Wars universe for the first time in a year.
Jedi Fallen Over.
Yes. I will be honest with you. It's a hard game to love, but if you want to have lots of nice wallpaper and you want to feel like a proper Jedi, then some of the fighting is really slick. Really slick. But just like proper fighting, you need to know what you're doing. You can't just swing the sword and just hope it works.
Is this on PlayStation or Xbox?
Yeah, it's on all platforms. It's on PlayStation, Xbox, and PC.
What are you playing it on?
I'm playing it on the PS4.
Ah, okay. So it's not like a Kinect thing that you're knocking over your wife's favourite vase with.
No, I'm not going around with a toilet tube and smashing over, going around with a toilet tube going, have at you, and sort of scaring the cat. No.
I've heard it's a game that actually does represent lightsaber fighting, like, probably the most accurately.
It is, because it's a case of you have to lock onto the person you're going to fight. You have to focus on them. I mean, if you just go swinging the blade around, people will just take you apart. But if you're facing the person, you can do parrying to knock them away, and then once you parry them, you can attack them again. And so you have to time your attacks. You have to time people shooting. If people shoot lasers at you, you can't just press a button and just have it defend. I mean, it will, but if you want to knock the bullet back at them, you have to actually time it right. You can't just hold down just a button. And I've got myself a nice double-ended lightsaber. Ooh, misses. So when because you can upgrade and tweak the lightsaber, you can change colours and you can change the handle and the make and the brass and all this kind of stuff. And I've got this blooming thing now, which I go around and literally helicopter through stormtroopers everywhere. But the funniest bit about it, and the thing that I actually did appreciate, was the sense of humour with some of the death sounds from the stormtroopers. Because I got this false push, and there was this one stormtrooper just standing there, and they all say random things. But there's one stormtrooper standing there on this platform, like about a mile up in the air, and we're all flying sort of above the clouds kind of thing. And as I hit him with this force power, I was expecting to knock him over, but I'd actually sent him over the edge, and he went flying over the edge. And as he went over the edge, he went, "I always knew I'd die like this." It was just this lovely, "I always knew it'd end this way." And it's little things like that, and he's like, "I should have..." You kill another one, and as he goes down, he goes, "I should have been a mechanic." Just taking them all out, flying through them. So it's got a sense of humour, but bloody hell, it's as hard as nails. It is an unforgiving game. It's not a game for you to just go in and just button mash, because you will die. And a lot of the levels are kind of laid out so that as you progress in your powers, you can come back to the old levels and sort of work through new bits and pieces you can now reach because you couldn't do before. So the level starts off as relatively small, and you think, "Ooh, what's this?" And by the time you've gone around a few planets and got a few extra powers and whatnot, you go back to the original planet and you're like, "Oh my god, I can now jump over this fence, I can now climb this wall, I can now blow this wall away and go through this bit. Oh, I found another secret." And it's just like the map opens up to like 16 times the size, and you're like, "I'm going to spend all day just wandering around this garden now, aren't I?" sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want scale, oh my god, it's got scale. I mean, it's got the whole thing of, you know, running around on the outside of a broken up Star Destroyer that's crashed on the ground, and it's like you're sort of 300 feet up in the air running around beating up probe droids and whatnot. And yeah, for your full-on Star Wars experience, it's probably right up there. But you've got to be good at the old sword fighting, because otherwise you're just going to be on a hiding to nothing and just screaming at it. Yeah, so that's that. The other Star Wars experience I had was I watched the whole of New Hope while doing some bike exercises. And
oh, wow.
Yeah. So for 2 hours, I was on a bike watching New Hope. And I've got to say, when you're in sort of leg pain, can I just say that you suddenly focus quite heavily on what's in front of you? And I have to say, by the time we got to just off the Death Star and heading towards Yavin, I have to say, I was getting a little bit bored.
You've seen it one too many times, haven't you?
I think so. I think, I think my Star Wars saturation has reached maximum, and yeah, my dislike of everything that's happened in the recent years with the bloody stuff. Yeah, I think I finally, that's it. I think I've completed my lack of love for the Star Wars universe now. I think I'm just playing Jedi Fallen Order just for a bit of nostalgia kick, but... Mm.
See, I had that when we recorded the Ghostbusters episode.
Yeah.
And it was just one too many times. I'd seen it so many times as a kid, and I got so familiar with it and loved it so, so much. It's like cuddling a kitten that you really, really love, but you cuddle it so much, you squeeze the life out of it. And that's what I did with Ghostbusters. And I feel that that's what you've done with Star Wars now.
Yeah. Yeah, so I was going to sort of go through the entire series, but while doing bike riding, just to keep myself interested. But I'm not sure I want to do Empire now, in case I go back to that and do the same thing. That would be bad.
That would be.
Yeah. Mm. Anyway, so that's pretty much my week. So, sorry for rambling on. But we move on to the feedback section, but we got a good feedback this week. You're going to like this one, guys. You're going to really like this one. Because, you know, sometimes people don't understand what the name of the podcast is all about. And if you're new here, and you're one of the millions of people who normally listen to Mayo and Commode, and you've heard us get a shout out, and then you went, oh, all right, we'll try them, and now you're about to hang up. Before you do, the reason it's called The Black Dog is because the whole thing was focused around, this whole thing formed around depression, essentially, and wanting to meet friends and reconnect with the world. And the Black Dog of the title was also called Winston, because that refers to Winston Churchill, who would refer to his depression as taking the black dog for a walk. That was his euphemism for it. Mm. So that's where it came from. That's where the title came from. And what happens now and again is occasionally people don't really know what it means, and so they decide that they want to cash in or try and get us engaged in things. And this feedback should give you some idea. Hi there, I'm Pete from the Goody Pet. Firstly, thank you for writing and producing all those amazing articles on dogs at blackdogpodcast.com. I've been sharing these articles and podcasts with my friends, and they really enjoy reading them. I was wondering if you would like to contribute to a guest post for our website. I have been a dog owner for the past 15 years and would love to share some of my tips with your readers. My published works have been featured in such articles as Healthy Pets, Fit Bark, and the Danbury Animal Welfare Society. If you're interested, please let me know. I'd be more than happy to prepare a few topics and discussions to send across to you. All the best, Pete. There you go.
Well, I think I need a chocolate for this one. 1 minute. Hold on. Oh, let's grab a Cadbury's caramel nibble.
Yeah. So that's a thing that happened.
I guess he didn't see Hunt for the Wilder People then.
No, he didn't see Hunt for the Wilder People. I don't think he watched. What was the other ones?
Code 8.
No, I don't think he watched Code 8.
Have I been on? Like, did I take LSD or something at some point? Because I don't remember writing any articles for any dogs or anything like this.
No.
Is it me? Am I just coming out of my sort of like, you know, the fucking obviously the tripping coma that I've been in for the past 10 years.
Just taking
please someone pill. Reassure me that I'm all right, that I've not been off my knockers on horse tranquilizers or something.
Well, I have to say, Darren, this is still 2009, and what? I got Jim and Elton to sort of join me while you have been out of the loop. We've only done 8 episodes.
I've been to the future.
How was 2020?
We got rid of one of them episodes as well.
We had to get rid of episode 4 after you had a bit of an embolism.
Right, okay, well, I'll just say about 2020, reverse. nuns, reverse.
Nuns?
Nuns? Yeah.
Yeah, nuns, reverse, nuns.
Yeah, I think that's reverse.
Father Ted nuns thing. Reverse to me again. I don't understand what nuns reverse means.
It's Father Jack seeing nuns in Father Ted. He goes, yeah, nuns, reverse, reverse.
He just speaks one word at a time. He's like, nuns, reverse, reverse.
Yeah.
He's like having a conversation with a 4-year-old. You're like, okay, what does that mean? And they just say it back to you again. You're like, I'm none the wiser than I was 30 seconds ago.
None the wiser. Get it?
Love it. Okay. So, thanks, Pete, from the Goody Pet. Yeah, obviously check his work out on Healthy Pets and Fit Bark and let's not forget the Danbury Animal Welfare Society.
How could you?
Exactly. What will they say at the Danbury, what is it? Danbury what?
Travelling Wilbury Society.
Yeah.
Oh, the Travelling Wilbury.
Pea and Potato Soup Society, I think. Potato Pot Pie Society.
Danbury, that's not too far from me.
Well, there you go. There you go, Elton. Maybe it's you. Maybe you're the one having the blackout.
No, it's not.
Pop in and say hello.
Right. Anyway, so that's that. That's the feedback. That's our week. And now it's time to roll the jingle because we're going to delve into the vaudevillian, ultra-violent, slightly weird and wacky world of Charlie Bronson. Roll the jingle.
I see it's nearly 5 o'clock. I'm here at home, my work's all done. No question where I'll be tonight, a place of cinematic fun. It's the lockdown, but I will not pout. Oh, my friends, I won't be seeing this out alone. There's Lee and Elton and Jim and Darren, all sitting far apart for social distance. We're at the Shutton Cinema, down in the bunker of Shun. Down in the bunker of Shun. Fellas, it's been nearly 5 years. You're gonna let me out now or what?
No. Right, okay, so Bronson. Yes, Bronson is a 2008 British biographical crime drama directed by Nicholas Winding Refn, co-written by Refn and Norman Brock. God blimey, what's it with the names
here? So good they named him twice.
Yeah, Brock. Norman Brock. The film stars Tom Hardy as Michael Peterson, known from 1987 as Charles Bronson. The film follows the life of the prisoner considered Britain's most violent criminal, who has been responsible for dozens of or so cases of hostage-taking while incarcerated. He was also given the name Charles Bronson by his fight promoter for bare-knuckle fighting years. And born into a respectable middle-class family, Peterson became known as Britain's most dangerous prisoner because of his violence, and Bronson was repeatedly put into isolation and solitary confinement, which contributed to his emotional problems. The film was released 17th of October 2008 at the BFI Film Festival, and later to March 2009 worldwide. It had a budget of £230,000. How much did it make at the box office, Darren? Do you reckon?
Digestive and two hobnobs.
A digestive and two hobnobs, okay. I think I know where this is going with his review, because I could tell him, I can tell Darren something about Nicholas Winding Refn that may...
No, you can't, Lee, because I already know about Nicholas Winding
Refn.
Flipping Refn.
I knew it.
Yeah.
Jim, how much do you reckon it made?
Two tubs of homemade body armor lard.
Body armor lard. If only we were still titling these podcasts based on the actual just best line as opposed to the film. Body armor lard. That's a classic. Right, okay. What about you, Elton?
Fucking £20. Is that all?
Fucking £20. Fucking £20. Hey, what you saw out there was class.
I'm giving you fucking magic.
You fucking magic. Okay. Well, actually... Well,
where's the next one, then?
Yeah, where's the next one? So, actually, it made £2.3 million. There you go. Is its total. I think it might have made a lot more than that in video releases, but that's the initial release. It only made $10,000 in America, though. And ended up making $100,000 in America over 10 cinemas in the end.
What do they know, though?
Well, there you go. Yeah, so... Right, well, I won't go into the responses and all that kind of stuff, because let's just get into the chat about it. So, just very briefly, before we get into the discussions, what did we all think about it? I know you liked it, Elton, because you picked it for this week, but we'll get to you last then. So, okay. Darren, what about you? What did you think about this? Just quickly, just generally, before we get into the chat.
Yeah, some really good music in it.
That's it, is it?
I like lard.
Get it on my arse. Get it on my arse. Not there, you homo. Get it on my arse.
Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up.
I think that's all you need to say.
That's it, yeah.
Okay. Jim.
I think I liked it. But I'm not entirely sure this film I'm going to go back to very, very often.
Okay.
It wasn't what I was expecting, though. I'll probably get into that later. It did sort of take me by surprise, shall we say.
Yeah, yeah.
Glad it wasn't in 3D.
Yeah. Yeah, little Tom was hardy, wasn't he? So, yeah, I mean... I have to say I'm a little nonplussed by this film. I've watched it twice in the last 3 days, trying to get my head around it. I'm not sure if I like it or just admire it, I think is probably the best way of putting it.
Okay.
I don't dislike it, but I don't love it. I have problems with it, but I kind of admire its art house-ness, shall we say, or its attempt at art houseness.
I think so, very much, yeah.
Yeah, cool. And obviously, Elton, over to you, sir. What about you?
Well, you say obviously. This is only the second time I've seen this.
Mm-hmm.
And I must admit, when did I watch it? I watched it Sunday. Did I watch mm-hmm. it Sunday?
Yeah, because we were going to watch it, didn't we? We both said that when we were doing the test.
Yeah. Either Sunday or Monday, right? But I sat down going, and it came to me pressing play, and I was sat there going, I don't know if I want to watch this or not. I think I've fucked up here. I think I've really cocked up here, and I don't actually want to watch my choice of film. I got to be honest with you. I have to be honest with you. Otherwise, I feel like I'm cheating you guys.
Mm.
But by the end of it, and I'll tell you the reasons why as well later on, but mm-hmm. by the end of it, I really liked it. There were moments where I felt uncomfortable, but I didn't quite like it as much as other sections. But overall, I came away liking it a hell of a lot more than I did on my first watch.
Right. Okay. Cool. Okay, well then, let's get on with it then, I guess. Well, I guess the question that comes to me straight away watching it was, how did you find it portrayed him with as a biography? How did you find it as a biography? I mean, Darren, you've never seen it before. Jim, presumably you've not seen it before, I'm guessing.
Nope.
And I thought I'd seen this before. I said last week I thought I'd seen this before, but actually it turned out that I was getting it mixed up with Chopper, the Eric Banner film, which I think it shares a lot of its DNA with in certain places.
Definitely, yes. Yeah.
But how do you think, coming at this from nothing, knowing nothing, and then leaving the cinema or leaving the screening, how did you feel the biography put it across? Did you know more about it? Did you feel like you knew the guy more?
I felt as though I knew less. I just know that he likes punching people. He drew some art, and that's all I think I know about him. This was just an art installation. It wasn't an actual biography. It was.
Mm.
You know, I don't feel as though I know anything more about Charlie Bronson at all, really. We sat there watching it, and it's like, oh, he's punching someone else now.
Mm.
And it's just, I don't know. It just, it wasn't, it didn't make him very 3D. He seemed quite a 2D character.
Mm.
I know we're talking about a real person here, but I'm talking about the portrayal on the screen. I mean, this is it. I don't know what Charlie Bronson himself is like. I know he's the most dangerous prisoner, but this didn't teach me anything that I probably couldn't have already worked out.
Mm.
Right.
You know, it's like somebody's read a few headlines and they've kind of written his biography from there. There's no... I don't know. It just didn't. Yeah, there's no revelations for me in this film.
Yeah, and you feel the same, Jim? I mean, like I say, you came at this from completely blank. Did you know anything about him? Did you think the film did anything to fill in the blanks? If you did,
I knew a little bit about him, and I knew he was kind of this celebrity crim, and I was kind of. I was expecting something that was going to be like Chopper.
Mm.
And I didn't quite expect this kind of... sort of strange format it sort of gave the movie. This kind of almost like this... It's like the whole film's like a flashback in his own head.
Yeah.
Almost. I mean, I think I actually learned something about him... but I don't think there's any huge, great insights to be gained from him.
No.
Because he doesn't have them in the first place in his own books. I thought it was kind of interesting. It's sort of fascinating. It sort of interested me right from the off in a way, because I've read a lot of crime books and books about, you know, psychopaths and sociopaths and whatnot. And I thought it was very, what immediately intrigued me was right from the off when he's going back to his childhood, he says, right, this has got nothing to do with my upbringing. It's no reflection on my parents, who were good, upstanding people. There was nothing wrong there. You know what I mean? Which that is unusual for a man of that type.
Yeah.
Because normally it's kind of, oh, look what you made me do. You made me glass you. And it's always somebody else's fault. And there's always no responsibility whatsoever with these sort of people.
Mm.
It's classic kind of, it is one of like a psychopath and a narcissist trait. It's already somebody else's fault. And everything is always twisted round. And they're all innocent lambs, despite having just done something thoroughly appalling that, you know. And that intrigued me. And that whole kind of, the basic thing of kind of, basically, I like living on the edge. I like fighting. I actually like being in prison.
Yeah.
And kicking off. And he couldn't tell you why himself. I thought that was interesting. It's one of those, I think I enjoyed the movie. Not one I'm probably going to go back to on a regular basis, but it was just sort of kind of weird and fascinating. But it's one of those things, I don't think it glorifies him. I think it shows him as kind of a fuck-up, and where it is maybe lacking in traditional beginning, middle, and an end sort of story. The fact is, real life doesn't work like that.
Yeah.
Sometimes not even the person themselves know why they're such an absolute fucking brass-plated knob jockey. Hi, Charlie, if you're listening.
Yeah, I was going to say. Yeah.
I do believe he's out in about 3 days, so packing, Jim.
Write a review then, can't he?
Hold on. There's someone at the door. Ding dong. Oh fuck. what about you, Elton? I mean, you've seen this before, and you've seen this now.
Yeah.
I mean, did you come away thinking you knew something more? I mean, because the thing with this, all these kind of movies is the whole point is it's a biography, so isn't it supposed to tell you something?
Yeah, it is a biography, but they can go one of many ways, biographies. They can just tell you a bit by bit, day by day, year by year, of the progression of this person that we're diving into.
Mm.
But I think this film takes a slightly different turn, where it's like a creation of an artist that you have here. He's trying to find out who he is subconsciously. We're trying to find out who and what he is as well, where he stands. And we really find out that he's a guy who's more comfortable in jail because it's not pushing the boundaries. That's his comfort zone, in jail. He knows how to deal with himself in there. And he can live in solitary confinement. He can live in a cell and just pace around and be very comfortable with that. When he looks the most awkward and the most out of his depth is when he's out in the real world. And we see that when he's coming home to his mum's house, when he comes out of jail, it's all very bravado. But also when he's thrown into a situation, like when he's sat on that sofa, he doesn't have the natural skills to deal with that because he doesn't deal with that in prison. He just deals with it with shouting, swearing, spitting, fighting, punching, and it's almost as if he's got like an inner aggression that he doesn't know how to express himself, and so he uses violence as his expression. Because we see a scene where I think he's in the mental institute, or he's just about to go in there, and someone walks up to him and he just clocks someone. That's it. He knocks them down, then he raises his hands because he knows he's going to be dragged away. It's that expression where He doesn't know how to express, communicate himself. And so the best way to do that is thump someone.
Mm.
And then he's kind of got a point across. But I think this is a building of a character of an artist and looking, he has to look inside himself to find out what is broken and what is missing. And that's the story, really. Where is this artist? Where can he find it? And once he, that's like the curtain call. Once he's produced it, yeah, right, come on, you fuckers, come and get him.
Hmm. Yeah, yeah, that's it. He just, you know, whacks himself down and, yeah, then let's have a fight.
Yeah. So I think there's a little bit more to it than it just being a biography. I think it's more of the person himself, but looking inside the person himself.
Right. So you think there's more to it than actually than just here's a bloke, he likes fighting, that's the end of that.
I think on the skin of it, it is just that.
Hmm.
It's very easy just to see it as that. But there is something else there, a little thread that runs through where you could look at it as the artist himself and the build-up of that artist.
Hmm. Right. Okay. I mean, I was trying to... I mean, because just going back to the whole thing of did I learn more or did I learn less? I mean, I was trying to work out what was missing all the way through. Because it just seemed like a constant tableau of, like, here's a fight, look, I'm a geezer, I'm having a fight, arg. And when it came to the details beyond the fight, beyond the anger, beyond anything, it just suddenly hit, it would jump like whole swathes of what clearly was something going on. You know, like when he gets out of prison, he goes to the, you know, to his Uncle Jack, the brothel place. And it's like, he clearly spent some time there, and clearly one of the, shall we say, ladies of negotiable affection fancied the arse off him. And
not with that fucking rug on your face.
Yeah, it's gonna be like kissing a fanny. And it was kind of like suddenly the film went, nah, I'm not interested in that. Let's get back to the fighting. And that was the problem I kind of had. And, you know, feel free to jump in on this, but I think that the film wasn't interested in telling a story of the character of the person, but telling a story of just the character that we all had in our heads of this guy as just being an absolute.
That's right.
Yeah, I think that's right. But you know what I mean?
There wasn't anything there. It just didn't. I don't know what the message it was trying to portray.
Mm.
You know, that's it. What is the point of this film? Is the thing. You know, it's like, what is the reason for me to watch this? What am I coming away with? Is it just watching cut scenes from a longer movie? Or, you know?
But didn't it make you feel awkward at any point, Theron?
It just made me sit there going, Jesus Christ, at some points. It's like, you try, there's no sympathy for me. I didn't have any sympathy for him at all. He kind of destroys that with some of his actions.
Mm.
It's like the one person who is actually outside of his, you know, his mother, the family, the one person that is actually nice to him and is not there to get anything out of him is the librarian, and look how he treats a librarian.
Mm.
And it's just, I've got no.
The librarian in the cell that he locks in and takes hostage.
Yeah, he walks in, he's just like, hey, you know, got some new books in here. I've got Ginny Cooper, I thought you might want to read that. You know, and it's, I don't know.
But he doesn't strike the librarian, though, does he?
No, he doesn't, but he terrifies him.
Yeah.
You know, it's just... There's nothing... They don't... The film itself... Like I say, to me, it was too much like an art installation. And knowing the director, I can see why I think that. Because I watched Neon Demon. Damn, you know? It's like, all you're interested in, mate, is... You seem to be more interested in the flashy stuff on the screen rather than actually giving it a point, you know, trying to teach us something. And it didn't. That's the thing.
Well, interestingly, I mean, you say about all the flash and none of the content sort of thing.
Yeah.
I have to say that about the second time round... Because, like I say, I did watch it twice. The second time round, I watched it and I was thinking, okay, what am I missing here? What? Because the first time round, I just came away from it just thinking, what was that? What was the point? And the thing that I watched the second time round, just watching it flat and just going, okay, right, I know what's going to happen, but let's see if I can see something else. It looked to me, for all the world, and like I say, I apologise if this is some chin-strokey bollocks or whatever, but it looked to me, for all the world, like someone trying to remake Clockwork Orange.
It had that, some of that feel about it.
Yeah. The sort of, like, as soon as the violence kicks in, up comes the classical music. As soon as the action comes in... Suddenly, everyone's a faceless, you know, he's a man against the system, sort of thing, and he can only express himself through anger. And, you know, and there's the whole thing of, like, whenever he's given any other emotion to deal with, that's when he either shuts off or, you know, and it just felt like they were trying to portray him in the same way as they do in Alex with you know, with Clockwork Orange, that, you know, he's just a guy who's looking for an outlet, and that outlet just happens to be violence, and Ludwig van Beethoven is Ludwig van.
Even with the Clockwork Orange, there's a point to that story, and the point is you can only be good if you want to be good.
Mm.
With this, there's nothing like that.
Yeah, but there's also the whole thing of, you know. You know, sometimes people are just irredeemably evil when they just, no matter what you do, and if you're changing them, you're changing them to be what you want, but they're not who they are. So that's, you know, because you get that with the scene in the asylum, where they're constantly drugging him. And you sort of like, he had a plan to get out. And he's planning to get out, you know, is the little bit that's missing from being in the asylum. Because in the asylum, he is effectively in a cage. He is effectively running the place. But what he doesn't have is the violence. So the only way he can get out is by being violent. I mean, I'm just trying to read between the lines here, but to me, that seemed to be the whole thing just seemed to be this, that the director's trying to make Clockwork Orange all the time, but without anything else behind it. Just like...
I think you're right with, like, the Clockwork Orange case. It has like a Stanley Kubrick feel to it as well, doesn't it? It's like the wide shots and weird colours that you have as well. But it's all like the framing of the big wide shots and the big buildings, etc. And it has that feel about it, but it also has that thing of where he's trapped in the system, but he wants to be trapped in the system, but the system doesn't know what to do with him because he's so violent. He keeps fucking it up for everyone else. He goes into prison and he's too violent, and then they put him into the mental asylum. The only way out of that is to be violent. And somehow, I lost the little thread where they actually certified him sane, and then he got released.
Mm. Well, apparently, I was looking into this. Apparently, that didn't happen.
Right.
So, that's all a bit of a fabrication, which leads to another problem with the whole thing. If it's art for art's sake, and they're just trying to make everything fit a narrative, then it stops being a biography. It just starts being, you know,
yeah.
Hey, look at this character, listen to this music. What's the point? Yeah.
Mm.
I mean, Jim, you were saying you had some problems with it and some inconsistencies and things that bothered you. What were they? I mean,
it was things kind of. You have no real kind of context for things. It's like when he gets out, he says, "Well, I knew Uncle Jack." I'm like, "Who the fuck's Uncle Jack?" you know what I mean? Never. Mm. It's one of those things. On one hand, it's kind of, I mean, I have a bugbear, an increasing bugbear about films that are based on a true story and films, often very worthy films, that recreate historical events. Because I am a historian, and I know what they're presenting is, to use a complex historical jargon technical term, fucking wanking horse shit. And I think it's very, very damaging because it gives people the wrong idea about our history. It distorts things. And it annoys me when you sort of take either a real life story or a bit of history and then you kind of knock the rough edges off and you make it a nice, neat three-act story. And it's kind of, story structure is important. I'm a writer myself, I know it. But sometimes if you're dealing with real life doesn't play by those rules. Mm. And once you start knocking the rough edges off, you start altering the truth. And that's bad for telling a true story. You say, oh, it's drama, blah, blah, blah. Well, yeah, make up another fucking story. Don't claim it's a real one.
Mm.
You know, just don't fudge it.
Yeah.
So on one hand, it's kind of, for a story like this, I kind of like the fact that it resisted that urge to say, here, you know, here's beginning, middle, and this is your takeaway point. There's your fortune cookie thing. Go, there you go. And, you know, you can feel morally uplifted and intellectually challenged, and I've summed it all up on this bit of paper for you. There you go. Don't be a nut and hit people. And if you do, maybe if you do some shit drawings, it might help. There you go. Very profound. Fuck off. Thank you, Tar. you know, I'm sort of glad it didn't sort of play up that angle because that would annoyed me.
Mm.
But at the same time, it kind of had, I don't know, I know what you mean, kind of how it feels almost like this bizarre sort of travelogue through his life.
Mm.
And it's just kind of like, you know, I mean, you know, I also always have a lot of time for films. Oh, it's a picaresque journey. Ah, you couldn't write a plot then. That's what that means, isn't it? but I think for this story, I think this had a certain just visceral quality of showing you this man's life and stepping back. And the more I think and thought about it, I thought, well, actually, there is a sort of point to it because it is trying to be almost documentary and sort of give you his point of view. Because let's face it, he has parlayed himself into this celebrity character and he's played into that. But at the same time, he doesn't know why he does it. And he is, like the governor said, he's saying, you know, Charlie, you know, you've got to stop on this nihilistic journey just to destroy yourself and destroy everything. There's got to be something else we can do for you, you know.
Hmm.
And that's, I think, the closest you get to the truth, that he doesn't even understand why he's doing it. And for if the film came round and sort of he had him realising, oh, actually, there you go, you know, there's no place like home. There's no place like home. Click my heels together, do the drawing and get out of prison. No, that wouldn't fly for me. I think actually, the more I think about that, actually, last scene, that very last scene where he's just howling in that cage, the more I think about it, the more I thought that was a very good conclusion because it just punctures the legend that's been sort of built up almost throughout the film. And it's kind of that's probably the final truth of him. That inside his head, it's like that all the time. In fact, that is the inside of his head.
Well, the cage itself is inside his head.
No. He's kind of mentally, he's forever just like this howling beast trapped in a cage in his own mind. He's, you know, he's imprisoned by these violent impulses. And while he's made the good fist, if you pardon the pun, of being like that and parlayed himself up into being Britain's most violent prisoner, then an outsider artist and what have you, at the end of the day, he's still got that fundamentally broken psyche that is just like a cage of violent impulses holding him in. And a lot of the time it fucking hurts to be like that.
Mm. Yeah.
Pretension maybe, but you know what I mean? But it's kind
no,
of...
No.
It's one of those... I finished and thought, well, that was very well made. That was very powerful. Not entirely sure what the point is, but it's kind of have ruminated over it all today. And the more I think about it, I thought, well, like, there is a kind of point, but it's kind of make a point without making a point and storifying it, and then you're lying. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Chopper's like that as well, though. Chopper's very disjointed as a storyline. Kind of, I want to watch Chopper again now and see Fat Eric Banana going through his paces. But yeah, it's an odd one, but I appreciate that it sort of made me think. It's made me think so much about it all today. Of kind of, well, did I like that actually or not? You know what I mean? Facile jokes about lard body armor aside.
Yeah, I mean that's the thing though, isn't it? It's kind of like, I mean, I know we're not all fans of this film, but compared to something like we've watched recently, like I don't know, like. The Code 8 or any of this sort of thing where you just come up, or even, you know, and I apologise for even comparing this because I don't think it's anywhere near as good as the film I'm about to compare it against, but even like Hunt for the Wilder People, those films, Code 8 or Hunt for the Wilder People, those films come, those films go, you kind of go, I enjoyed that, I didn't enjoy that, whatever. There's a couple of extra little nit tidbits you can take away. This film, for good or ill, is up in your face and trying to shout and get your attention. It might not have a lot to say, but it does. But like you, Jim, I came away thinking about it enough to want to see it a second time to see if I actually missed anything, or if there was actually something to it, or if it was The Emperor's New Clothes, which in some ways is laudable, even if it's a complete freaking shit show and the complete failure, or something that you don't necessarily like, and you still are challenged enough to go, well, it's still niggling at the back of my head. You know what I mean?
I think it does a great job of making you feel, or making me feel very uncomfortable. Most of the time when you're sat in the room with Bronson himself. And it's for a number of reasons, really. Mm-hmm. It's my first watch when I saw this. It made me feel disturbed. It was trippy. I wasn't sure what I was actually watching. It was a very uncomfortable watch my first time round. This time, I think I kind of have put the nail on the head with this one. I've kind of worked it out. It has that Sergeant Pepper's kind of feel to it. It's got the Blue Meanies kind of feel. I know that his art is a very small representation of that, but it has that weird psychedelic feel. And I remember as a kid, saw the Blue Meanies, and I think I had nightmares about the Blue Meanies.
What, like, and you mean Yellow Submarine?
Yellow Submarine, yeah, yeah. And like all the hands and the weird smiles and stuff like that. It just creeped me out a little bit. And I had a nightmare about it, and I had trouble that night recovering from it. And whenever I see that sort of thing on screen again, like when he's doing the two people in conversation, like him and like a judge or something. I think he was acting
a parole officer, wasn't it?
Yeah, the lady, yeah. When he was doing that, I felt very uncomfortable with it. It's just like a stylistic thing that I just don't feel very comfortable with. But then you also have scenes where you're sat in a room and you can see him kind of trying to process his conversation where he's, okay, someone has said something to me. Like when someone asked him for a cup of tea.
Mm.
I think it was that King guy. He asked him for a cup of tea. And
that's right, yeah.
He passed him the cup of tea and went, oh, you've got lovely guns on you. And he made them fists. But that was his communication of, you've made me feel uncomfortable. I don't want to react to it just yet. And it was all stifled. And I just sat there feeling really tense and going, oh, God, what is going on? And there's lots of scenes like this throughout where it's just you have a moment of a kind of a pause where he's acting, and then you're left there with the big pause to think, what is he going to do? What is he going to react to? We all ultimately know what he's going to do with his reaction, and that he's going to swing his fists. But when you draw it out like that and give yourself a pause, it gives you time to second guess what he's going to do, and then third guess, and then, oh, no, maybe he won't. And I just felt, I honestly felt uncomfortable watching this sometimes. There are moments where I'm like, don't know what's going to happen.
Mm. But I guess is that, are you fearing the violence, or are you just fearing watching it play out and with some kind of inevitability? Because that was the thing I found watching this, and again, anyone wants to jump in, go for it. But watching it the second time round, I just came away thinking, actually, once you get past the, yes, something violent's going to happen, and he's got some weird moral code about the whole thing, you just kind of go, right, okay, fine, so why am I uncomfortable now? When he's like sitting on the stairs in that, after talking to his artist mate, and he's got the little black pebbly glasses on. Mm-hmm. And he's just completely blank, and you're thinking, oh God. Now you know that there's going to be violence. But
you don't know that there's going to be violence, because you had that cup of tea scene where there wasn't violence, but you were brought up to feel tension and you didn't get it.
Hmm. But that's the question, is what I'm saying is it the threat of violence is more tense than actually the violence itself by the end of it?
I think it's the and I've met people like this before where you don't know how they're going to react.
Mm.
But you always expect the worst because you've seen them react the worst way.
Mm.
So, I mean, that's how I see it. I mean, the bit where the guy goes off for a cup of tea is like a shark.
Mm.
Bronson's like a shark coming up behind him, and it's like, is he going to bite, or is something else going to happen?
Mm.
So, basing that on personal experience, that in itself, those scenes, it's like, those are uncomfortable.
Mm.
You know? Is that the kind of thing you mean, Elton? You've probably met people like that yourself.
Yeah.
Where
running in the rough circles you do.
Exactly. Or even like, you know, some kids at school.
Oh God.
Yeah. Where you think they act friendly, and all of a sudden you realise they're not friendly.
Yeah. Mm.
They're actually lulling you into a false sense of security. Not that that's what he's doing, because he generally seems to have a processing issue, which can take him from being calm. It's like when he first goes into the art class, you see him, he starts laughing at that guy's comment.
Mm. Yeah.
And then, you know, he's basically, the guy's, you know, supported him. He said, yeah, you've got a real talent. And even when he stood there in front of the prison warder, and he's the guy saying, well, you know, Charlie's bought something for you to have a look at. Are you not going to take it? And he says, you know, I'll give it to my assistant here. He'll make sure I look at it later. You know, it's like, again, there's a person who tried to help him, and look where it got him.
But
look at the tension that was in that scene. Bronson didn't say a word, and yet you know that there's tension there, especially when he tries to take it out of the picture out of his hands.
That's more to do with the way that Tom Hardy portrays it, though. You know, I mean, that's the performance. I've got no real problem with, you know. That's it. He plays Charlie Bronson exactly how I'd expect Charlie Bronson to be.
I was gonna say, how did we? Because I've noticed we've only been talking about Charlie Bronson the character, or we've not talked about Tom Hardy the actor, and that's kind of a telling statement, don't you think?
I've personally meant the performance, right? Because I don't know. This is the thing. This is my point with this film. I don't know anything more about. I don't know whether this film does Charlie Bronson justice or not. This is it. It's like, well, does it? Is he actually like this? Are you just doing this because, well, this makes a good film, doesn't it? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I did actually notice up until last year, well, actually last year, by the looks of it, Charlie Bronson did cause another riot in prison.
Did he?
Yes. They've got, I'm pretty sure that's what the report said. I looked at the date of it and it's 2019. It's like I say, there's nothing wrong with Tom Hardy's performance. Right? I mean, I believed that performance. That was it. You know, he had the right feel about him.
Yeah.
But, yeah. The performance was good.
But we're all
he wasn't
a bit
trying to do a funny voice.
We're all a bit disappointed with the actual result of what we got.
Because
when I was at school, right, you are all my teachers, right? And I wrote a report in a science class, first or second year in secondary school. And we're all given like you have to write a report about a scientist. And I went, I don't know any scientists, Albert Einstein. And so I tried to write a report about Albert Einstein. And do you know what I used as my subject to actually learn about Albert Einstein?
Back to the Future.
Young Einstein.
Who's serious?
Nice.
No, yeah. I said in my report, Albert Einstein invented the electric guitar. And so you guys are watching this as if like you've received my report about Bronson and you've got this and it's someone else's makeup of you've seen like an advert for Bronson.
Yeah.
Are you feeling...
know what? It's the same scene they play for this, though. It's a shut up. Shut up, you cunt. Shut up. Shut it. Shut it. They always play that to represent this film. They don't really play any other scenes.
Because I think it sums up the film perfectly, because it's just like that sudden burst of violence that just has the guy sitting there almost terrified for his life without any real understanding of what's just happened. You know, he's literally shell-shocked by the fact that all he's done is said Jilly Cooper, and next thing he knows he's being threatened with ultra-violence, and then the guy's getting naked in front of him and asking him to lard his arse.
Yep.
I mean, that's traumatising for anyone. I don't get... But I was gonna say, one of the things... with this, not being disappointed with it, I guess I am overall. I don't feel like I've wasted my time. I'm glad I at least seen it. But I think the problem I have with it is I wanted more than just an art house director waving his finger at me saying, you sympathise with him, but you know you shouldn't. which is essentially what I got from it in the end. Like I say, going back to the Clockwork Orange thing, it was that whole thing of here is like pure id, toxic masculinity, whatever you want to call it. And yet somehow there's something about it that's supposed to be alluring, or at least portrayed to make you feel like, on the one hand, you're sitting there going, oh, this guy, really, seriously? But on the other hand, he's a creature of clear purpose. He knows what he wants. He knows what he wants to get, and he knows what he wants to do to get it, regardless of how he actually does it. Mm. And you're sort of supposed to, I always got the sense that you're kind of supposed to kind of admire it. I mean, did anyone else get it? I mean, I'm not saying glorifying it, but just kind of like that kind of weird half line, sort of a line between art and exploitation. You know, the film's kind of going, look at all this. But then on the other hand, it's going, oh, look at the violence. You know, and the other one, it's kind of, oh, look at the pretensions of the art without the artist, or the artist without a goal with a canvas. And then there's another bit going, yeah, and then he fucks up some screws with a punch in the face while he's larded up. It's just like, no, just fucking pick a lane. Right. Are you going to exploit this guy and go, here's a film about ultraviolence, or are you going to go completely artistic and do that whole vaudeville thing that ran throughout the whole film and just go, you know, actually there's a person inside trying to be heard, and outside he's got some reason that he can't be heard, so he just basically plays out all of his emotions through violence.
I think he was sort of trying to do both. I think it was kind of, I think it was made with an awareness of the kind of celebrity crim culture.
Mm.
And the violence. I mean, it's one of those things, you know, you can make the most appalling, violent, disgusting film with very high art ideals.
Mm.
And fucking headbangers are still going to be passing around going, watch this, it's really cool, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's kind of unavoidable, and it is kind of the thing about violence in cinema is it's kind of, if you, I was, my line is, I think violence without consequences.
Mm.
I think that violence without consequences is often more dangerous than graphic violence.
Mm.
I mean, I think this film sort of, it shows you him sort of reacting to the prison system by going, I could be the biggest nutter in here. I'm not a family thing. Mm. And that's a way he copes with prison. And basically, I think he almost got the sense halftime he's just kicking off just to, you know, go back in solitary so he's left bloody alone.
Well, there is that, I guess, isn't there?
And I think on one hand, while you do get the ultraviolence, at the same time you do get consequences of the ultraviolence, he gets the shit beaten out of him.
Mm.
And then you start going, actually, it's not so cool being Britain's hardest criminal, is it?
No.
I think it's a fine line, it's a delicate balance, but I kind of, in rumour, I think it does sort of pull it off. I think it justifies the violence it shows to you.
Mm.
Not in a way, I mean, you'd have a whole slew of Brit gangster movies, which I think were doing the classic ultraviolence, but there's no consequences, and just that just makes it cool.
Mm.
But when you get the aftermath of broken teeth, spitting blood, getting the absolute crap beaten out of you, and he's not winning in the slightest, and then put in a box, he's like, not so good. This being Britain's most violent criminal, is it?
Mm. Yeah,
and I think it's like good extreme cinema. I think it gives you, confronts you unflinchingly with the violence, but it's also equally unflinching with the consequences.
Yeah.
It's an interesting one. I mean, certainly I think kind of, I know why the Celts went into battle naked now, according to the Romans, because it's like a greased up naked man coming at you with a spear is fucking more terrifying than a man in armour. Because he's going like, Christ, all right, everything's off the table now, isn't it?
Yeah, this is a man. This is a man with nothing to lose if he's got his nadgers out facing a guy with a sword. Yeah,
yeah.
What's that slapping coming over the hill? Oh.
Oh God! It looks like a dozen dead mole rats are flying at me. Oh my God!
Swing low, sweet testicles.
Okay, I'm just going to jump back onto like the artist of him as well, because you have this artist within him as well, and it's only until he starts doing all these drawings and paintings, and he's told, don't look for the thing that you are looking for. Look for the thing that shouldn't be here. And that's kind of where he gets his creativity from. He's looking for something that he can't find. Mm. And the crescent... Well, all the way through the film, you have the narration, which is a weird way of doing it, him narrating it, but in all these different faces as well, trying to portray him in different guises. But then you have that crescendo of him grabbing the art teacher in like a flurry of fury and violence, which was like, Darren, like you said, like a shark walking behind him. You see him, you're like, oh dear. It's every Ripper film that we've seen with like the stalker behind. You're like, oh God, something is going down. And when you just see them hands go around his face and pull him down, you're like, oh God, what's going on? But he doesn't seem to beat the shit out of him. He just ties him up and turns him into the art that he was looking for to create. And once he'd finished it, and himself was like a statue of part of the art, I suppose. But once he'd finished painting the guy's face, he looked at it. You had that, once again, that real long pause. And then he was like, right, come on, you fuckers. And it was his art was done.
The line that stuck out for me in that scene was, all right, he's had enough now, come and get him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which did make me laugh. Maybe it was like a nervous sort of laugh, but it was just kind of like, it was a relief that, oh, he's not going to actually do him over. But yeah, I think he just made a point of kind of, all right, you try to take me to the art world, I'll do you some art and take you into my world, see how you feel. Had enough now? Okay.
I think, yeah, I mean, I think that's the thing, isn't it? It's that whole thing of him being unapologetic and completely amoral about the whole thing. He's just like, yeah, I've done this because I wanted to do this. It's done. Fine, I'm not bothered. I'm not going to go any further because I don't really care. It's amused me as far as it needs to. Now, come on, you come and get him. Let's have a fight. Let's get it all over and done with. And I guess that's the other thing. I mean, it's kind of both interesting and irritating. Is that because there is seemingly no reason for him to be the way he is, you kind of are looking for a reason, which makes the film feel like you are missing something. You're sitting there going, well, hang on. If it isn't his parents and it isn't the situation he's brought up in and it isn't some kind of mental disturbance, which, you know, clearly it is, but you know what I mean? There's nothing causing him to be this way. He just is that way. Then you're left with a kind of feeling that, like, oh, right, so there's no explanation, there's no catharsis coming down the pipe from this. We're just going to have to accept that he's a nutter. All right, geezer. Anytime he feels like it, he has a bit of a punch-up. And so without any reasons, we're talking about it, but we're trying to discern reasons. We're not actually getting anything from the film. It just kind of, that kind of acts as a bit of an irritant, I think, is that whole thing of you're looking for a reason, but there is no reason to get. It simply is the way he is because that's the way he wants to be.
I think that's the frustration that the system has, though, because it is just there's no rhyme or reason to it. There's no trigger for it. It just happens.
Mm.
And so what does the prison system do with that sort of thing? They don't know how to deal with that. Other prisoners, you could probably... There's a pattern to it. With him, there's no pattern. There's no display pattern. One minute he could be all right. Next minute he's a tornado.
Mm.
And so how do you deal with that? Well, just stick him in solitary. And that, surely that can't help matters at all. That is just a case of, if we could remove this guy from the system completely, we would, but we can't. So we just put him in a box under the stairs and hope it goes away for a couple of months.
Which is interesting, because that was the kind of thing I thought the film was trying to get at in the end, was that, you know, if people had just acknowledged him from the start, or just, you know, gave him some kind of, if he had some kind of other outlet, then things might have gone differently. But the fact is that, you know, he robbed a post office. We don't really know why, but he did. He robbed a post office. Next thing you know, he's in prison. And then he just decides, right, okay, this is how I'm going to make my way. I'm going to have a fight and make myself the hardest bastard in this prison. That connection of dots between, here's a picture of him with his wife and kid doing the ironing, and in the next shot, here's the post office I did over. Next shot, here I am beating up a couple of prison guards. It's like, how did you get from A to B and seemingly via Z? It's like, what? And that was the problem. I had a kind of, that's where I kept twitching, because it's just like, you can't drop that kind of sort of time skip on us and then say, nah, I just did it for whatever reason. Because if you're just presented with a character who just doesn't change from start to the end of the film and is exactly the same and seemingly is just doing things because, A, shits and giggles, then you're kind of like, why should I care? Why should I be interested? But on the other hand, they kept throwing in all this stuff about art and him sort of like trying to put across all this information to this imaginary vaudeville theatre audience. And you're thinking, well, okay, then maybe there is a point to it all. Maybe there is something he's trying to tell us. But watching it twice, I can tell you there's nothing he's trying to tell us. He's just sitting there going, and then I did this, and then I did that, and then they weren't happy, so I had a fight. It's just like, right, okay, now what? It's weird. I'm like in Jim's camp. I'm almost like, I admire it despite the issues I have with it. And I have a lot of issues with it, I think. But I kind of sit in there going, well, you know, it's kind of a film that almost with a different director would have just become like a standard kind of, oh, he's a geezer, he's all right. You know, can you imagine like Guy Ritchie doing this?
Good Lord.
Well, we've sort of seen that film in the past, like what's that Phil Collins bullshit? Buster.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. Buster, he robbed a train. He was all right. All right, some cunt might have got killed. Ignore that. Oh, fuck him. He's all right, though. Look, he sells flowers. He's a geezer. It's fine.
Yeah.
And he looks just like Phil Collins. Core.
They love their mother. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's kind of, I like, we don't have those rough edges not sanded away.
Mm.
Of the, you know, no one knows why fucking Bronson's like Bronson. Not even the psychologist. Mm. He doesn't know. And it would be disingenuous for the film to try and tell you. Mm. Even though that doesn't necessarily make for the usual sort of takeaways you expect. But
yeah.
Sometimes the unexpected is good. Mm. I appreciate how much it's made me think. Because I've thought kind of, well, is it a commentary about the prison system?
Yeah.
This is how this guy just reacts to it. And it's kind of, prison actually was always his ideal environment.
Mm. Yeah.
It was perfect for him. You know what I mean? Or was that just his way of adapting? I don't know.
his way of coping with the situation he found himself in.
So, certainly, it's kind of, yeah, I want to stay out of prison. That's one of my other takeaways. not like porridge, is it? Sitting around playing dominoes and having a laugh. No.
Yeah, Mr. Fletcher, sir. Yeah. Okay, then. Well, to wrap it up, is there any last thoughts? Anyone got any last thoughts on this, Darren?
No. really? I think I've said all I can about it. Like I say, I didn't come away with anything.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
This film.
As soon as I saw who directed it, and then I looked on the wiki and I saw what else he directed, I thought, oh, Darren's not going to enjoy this.
Well, Mr. Placides actually tipped me the nod on that one.
Oh,
he went,
good.
Have you seen the director? And he put a little smiley, winky face, and I'm thinking, oh, is it? Because I thought when I don't know if I was concentrating properly on what he wrote. I thought I was going to find out that it's Pierce Brosnan that actually, you know, directed Brosnan.
Mm.
And it's like Bronson. So it's a name thing, you know, but no. Mm. And then I realised who it was. It's like, oh, for fuck's sake.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've only seen one film that bloke's done that I thought was all right. And that was Drive.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that was it. And it's just like, you know. Yeah. Neon Demon. That's all I'll say.
Yeah, that was the thing. As soon as I saw that and I saw Neon Demon in his previous credits, I just thought, oh no.
It is the Batman Ninja of live action, that film.
So you won't be watching any more of his films, Mr. Windham?
Probably not.
No? Okay.
Probably not.
And unless I put them on the docket.
Oh, God.
Well, yeah.
But if it's Drive, then fine, you know. But, I don't think I'm willing to give any of his other films a chance, if I've got to be totally honest.
Okay, fair enough. Cool. What about you, Jim? Any last-minute takeaways before we wrap up?
Always keep some lard handy.
Yeah. Oh, grease my arse. No, not in my arsehole, you homo. Jesus Christ. Okay, what about you, Elton?
Well, first off, I'd like to apologise to Darren.
For what?
I'm very, very sorry.
It's fine, mate. Don't worry.
I can, as soon as we sat down and we were just about to talk about it, I could just hear it. I could feel the tension already from your side of things. I was like, oh,
I was looking
dear.
Forward to watching this film. Yeah. Honestly, I was, because, you know, there's the whole, that very famous clip that I said they keep showing of it. Mm. And I don't know. Yeah. There you go. I watched it. That's it. You know, I've done it now.
I watched it. That's it. There's my review.
I've watched it now, so
stick that on the poster.
Let's move on swiftly.
Lovely.
Well,
worst screen chill sequel ever.
Anyone who didn't like it or anything like that, I apologise. But I feel that sometimes you need a little bit of difference to spice it up a little bit, and that is what I've given you here tonight. Something different that you wouldn't normally choose to watch.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't totally despise this like I do Neon Demon. So, you know, it wasn't like I was sitting here in pain watching it or anything. So, no, yeah. You didn't make the bloody thing anyway, so why should you apologise?
Mm. No. Well, I enjoyed this a lot more the second time round. I got a lot more from it, and I felt I invested in it a little bit more as well. So I'm glad I chose this one. I'm happy I've seen it, and I feel confident that I will watch it again.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I've come away thinking that maybe it's been too long since I've gone in for some proper old school art house movies, because Nicholas Winding Refn seems to be having a crack at them, but I don't know. The jury's still out on whether or not he's just style and substance, rather than substance, or whether or not there's something there. I mean, I have never managed to make it through Drive because I just can't get past Ryan Gosling being a plank of wood, being out-acted by his own hammer. Maybe I need to watch a few more art house movies, see if I can get my brain flexing back into that kind of look at the symbols and not the story on the page. In fact, hey, maybe we should watch Prospero's books. Who doesn't like a bit of Peter Greenaway to drive you fucking nuts? Probably everyone, I think. So my takeaway is that I'm glad I've watched it. It was enough to make me watch it twice. The second time was under duress, I'll be honest with you. But I'm kind of glad I've seen it, and I'm kind of thinking about it, even though I didn't feel there was much there to think about. But it's kind of, the more we're talking about it, the more we've talked about it, it's more I'm just thinking there must be something there. I'm going to start having a read of a few reviews now and just see if there's anything more that I've missed. But I'm kind of glad I've seen it, but I don't think it's a film I'm going to return to again for a very long while, or perhaps ever. But we'll see. So that's it. So did anyone out there in the audience watch this? Do they have any thoughts? Is there anything we've said or anything that we've maybe mentioned that maybe has prompted a thought, or we're all wrong and you want to tell us? In which case, send us a feedback in. Send us an email to feedback@blackdogpodcast.com. If, on the other hand, you're from a dog website or write about dogs, perhaps just give it a miss and listen to the podcast for 5 minutes and see whether or not we actually discuss the types of dog breed or not. Perhaps.
And stay away from Dogging UK. Little tip for you there.
Yeah. If there's anyone from Dogging UK who wants to tell us their the next site, we'll happily promote that for money. That'll be our unique USP. Yeah. For 50 quid, we will promote your dogging site on this podcast. Anyway. So there you go. That'll be a way of paying for new equipment.
Wind your windows down, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, remember, turn your lights on if you want to be viewed, and off if you don't. Anyway, moving on before I say too much. Right, so that's that. That was Bronson. So now it's time to find out what our next film's going to be. And I don't know it. Nobody else knows it except for Jim. Jim.
Yes, and even I might change my mind.
Oh, hang on. No, okay, then. Go on in, sir. So what have you decided for us?
I'm just checking. It hasn't been disappeared in this afternoon since I looked at it.
Okay.
I was looking and saying, well, what can we get? What can we watch?
Mm.
And the curse of the streaming culture is it's often very hard to search these platforms.
Mm.
I discovered this by complete chance.
Mm.
And I was actually delighted to find it.
Mm.
It's a film from the 80s. I saw it on video circa 1985, 1986.
And
okay. Not heard anything about it. We thought it looked funny. And I remember we really enjoyed it. It's called Monster in the Closet, and it's on Amazon Prime, free to watch.
Monster in the Closet?
Yes.
Wow.
It's fairly low budget, but what it is basically, you know how kids think there's a monster in the closet?
Mm-hmm.
Well, in this movie, there is. And people disappearing by the score into closets. And it is kind of like done as like a pastiche of like 50s monster movies.
All right.
With all the kind of like cliches. And even pastiches a few more modern things, which I won't spoil, of one actually ludicrous scene that I remember falling off the sofa laughing at. I've not seen it since being a teenager in the late 80s. It may well have aged horribly, but I remember it was out 1986, out there on the same time as Critters.
Oh, right. So
cashing in on that. You know, like Critters has that kind of... sending up old B-movie sort of stick. Monster in the Closet is like that, but does it better. That's my memory of it. Whether it holds up, we don't know. But I thought we needed something lighter after Bronson.
Yeah. Right, Monster in the Closet. Okay. Mm-hmm. Right, well, I'll be honest with you. I'll lay this out flat. I have never seen this. I hadn't even heard of this film.
Most people seem to have never have seen it at all.
Right.
Got Paul Kevin Walker Peter and Hall. John Carradine.
Yep.
Paul Walker,
and Henry John... Gibson.
Oh my God, Henry
who you
Gibson.
Will recognise.
And Fergie from the Black Eyed Peas. What?
What?
What? What? Could, Paul Walker. All right, okay. I'm
not that kind of monster.
Okay.
Claude Atkins. Blimey.
Good Lord.
Howard Duff.
Okay. Donald Moffat. Well, clearly there is. Clearly, this is going to be an... actually, you know what? I've just seen the poster. I have seen the DVD poster. I think this is a Fangoria era type movie.
Pretty much. I think Fangoria is the only place I ever saw it mentioned who had a little article once about the effects.
Yeah.
And like, apart from me and my friends, no other person I've ever met has seen this movie.
Right, okay.
I was beginning to think it didn't exist, to be honest.
And it actually is on Amazon Prime.
Yeah, yes.
Right.
Okay. I was looking through 80s comedies, bizarrely.
Okay. And I've seen who's distributed it. I think I'll leave that there. I won't say anything.
It's not their usual fare, shall we say.
It's not their usual oeuvre.
No,
okay.
No.
Okay, well, I tell you what. This is going to be... It's going to be an interesting one, I think. Yeah, Elton, have you seen this? Have you even heard of this?
No, give over. I haven't seen this.
Well, I don't know. Because you can surprise us sometimes. But, okay. Darren, I'll
I
take
thought you
were around.
Taking the mickey when you said Fergie out of Black Eyed Peas, but no, she's actually in it.
Stacey Ferguson, Fergie.
Looking at some of the films that it suggested coming off of this as well, and... Oh my God. Oh look, Attack of the Killer Tomatoes.
Well, yeah.
I was very tempted to pick Rabid Grannies.
Oh my God.
or Teenagers from Outer Space, but I resisted.
Poultry Goose.
Space Raiders. Oh my God. Transylvania 65,000.
Oh good Lord, no. 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 I'm vetoing that right now. No.
No, that's horrible. I know, I own it on DVD.
Frankenstein Island.
Right then. Well, I tell you what, before we get too far down this road of going, oh my God, let's wrap it up because I think next week's going to be an interesting one. Right. So before we go, Jim, do you want to tell us where everyone can find your stuff?
Well, if you go to hypnagoria.com, you can find all my wares, including many articles, some very clever about folklore and some not so clever about crap board games. And my three podcasts, which are running. Tomorrow, I'm releasing a new commentary club where me and Teresa look at one of the worst films ever made, Robot Monster from 1953. I'll also be releasing on my From the Library of Dreams. I think I'm going to release a full, complete, all-in-one audiobook of The Colour from Outer Space. And on my main show, Hypnagoria, I'm talking more about the writing and themes of colour outer space, delving into the science behind the story, about early radioactivity and other fun things.
Nice. Cool. And what about you, Elton?
You can catch me on Into the Expanse, which is a podcast talking about The Expanse, believe it or not. That you can find all that over at rogue2media.com.
Brilliant, brilliant. And Darren, have you managed to get your baking website off the ground?
No.
Okay.
Not at all.
Have you appeared in any podcasts recently?
No, not right. at all.
Okay, fine. Never mind. I like to give you the option, though, to promote yourself.
Well, thank you. Thank you. That's great.
So Darren is appearing nowhere.
Yeah. This week, when I've got nothing to promote, and your boss hasn't decided to give you, you know,
yeah,
3 weeks worth of work for one night, I've got nothing. Nothing to promote.
Okay. Well, yes, you can catch me on, well, I've not done any artwork recently, but I will be back on that soon. But you can catch my Instagram, which is instagram.com/cartoonbeardy, artstation.com/cartoonbeardy, and you can also follow us, the Black Dog, on Twitter, which is @blackdogpodcast. And you can also join us on the Facebook group, which is facebook.com/groups/theblackdogpodcast. And once again, if you have any thoughts about Bronson, you want to just send them in to us next week, then send that in to feedback@blackdogpodcast.com. Right, well, that's it then. So, next week, Monster in the Closet, eh? Well, this is going to be an interesting one. So, thank you, Jim. Thank you, Darren. Thank you, Elton.
No problem.
And, yeah, thank you everyone for listening. Stay safe out there. It's not everything going a bit on the crazy side, to say the fucking least. And whatever side of the pond you're on, hope you all stay safe. And until next week, take care, and we'll see you all next time. Till then, tatty bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Ta-da.
Oh, bollocks to it.